Hey, everybody. I'm Alix Steele, anchor for Bloomberg Television, and I'm very excited about our next guest, Robert M. Blue, Chair, President, and CEO of Dominion Energy. We're going to talk about the community-conscious energy future. We're greening the world, but how do you do it in a hard-to-decarbonize sector like utilities? Bob, it's great to be here with you. Thank you so much for joining.
Thanks for having me, Alix. I look forward to the conversation.
So I think it's valuable to just kind of start off of where was this industry 10 to 15 years ago? And then kind of where are we right now? And I think that that'll be a good basis to kind of dissect what's going on in Dominion.
Yeah, I think that that's a great way to think about it. You know, I started working at Dominion 16 years ago in 2005. And my first year, that year, we generated 50% of our electricity that year from coal. Fast forward to last year, we generated 10% of our electricity from coal. What we have done during that time period is shift more to natural gas. Throughout that time period, we continued to generate, you know, roughly 35% of our electricity from nuclear, emissions-free, carbon-free, natural gas, fewer emissions than coal, but still has some CO2 emissions. So cleaner burning than coal, not as clean as nuclear. And what I would expect going forward is we'll probably start to supplement in a lot more renewables than we have so far. And by 2035, we will essentially be generating no electricity from coal at our company. Our gas contribution will be smaller and our renewable contribution will be substantially greater.
So let's unpack a couple of those. So let's just go with natural gas for a second. I've been covering the energy space for a long time, and I feel like for a while, natural gas was the much-loved bridge fuel between oil and solar and wind. And then it became a dirty word, as in, like, it's still really dirty, it's not clean enough, it got kind of smushed over with oil. And then now it's starting to come back to that bridge fuel scenario. How do you think it's evolved?
Yeah, never dirty at our company. Because I think it's really important for people to understand that it is natural gas that is allowing us to add the renewables that we are. The fact is, the wind doesn't always blow and the sun doesn't always shine. And sometimes we go for extended periods of time where the wind doesn't blow and the sun doesn't shine. And natural gas is what allows us to continue to operate the electric grid in those environments. So it gives me comfort as the leader of an energy company, that as we add renewables, which we should absolutely be doing, and we have a very aggressive plan to do that, that we'll have natural gas there to make sure that we can continue to operate our grid reliably. And we're also, by the way, a natural gas distribution company. Our customers want natural gas. They want to use it for heating their homes. They want to use it for cooking. So we think about ways that we can green our natural gas business as well. But fundamentally, natural gas is going to be essential for us to continue to operate the grid. And then if you step back and just look at our energy picture more broadly, having both an electric grid and a gas grid provides us a substantial amount of resilience, which we all know is incredibly important. We need to keep the heat on when it's cold, and we need to keep the lights on as well.
Do you feel like that message is getting out there in terms of shareholders, governments, pipeline approvals? Like, do you think that the world is recognizing that scenario you just laid out?
Well, I think policymakers understand that this transition, as we think about it, to a greener energy needs to be done in an orderly way that doesn't sacrifice reliability. Our customers want to their lights on and their gas flowing 100% of the time. That is job one for us, has been for the entirety of our existence and will continue to be job one for us. Our customers want their energy to be affordable, and increasingly they want it to be green. So as we think about this, what we tell policymakers, and I think they understand, we want to get green as fast as we can, reliably and affordably.
One more question on natural gas. So it seems like Dominion's considering a large new natural gas plant that would have a lifespan that exceeds your 2050 net zero goal. What would you say to someone who says, well, that doesn't mesh with your plans?
Yeah, so you may be thinking about our South Carolina business. In Virginia, we've recently built within, you know, the last decade, we finished these several years ago, some very highly efficient combined cycle natural gas plants. And that's what I said gives me the comfort that mm-hmm. we can add as many renewables as we want. In South Carolina, there may be the possibility for some additional natural gas there, but that's because we have an aging coal fleet in South Carolina, and it makes sense to shift to something that will allow us again to keep the lights on as we retire coal. I think fundamentally, this debate is about how quickly can you go, again, reliably and affordably, and what I would tell those who argue that we shouldn't be investing in natural gas at all, that we need to be able to maintain the reliability and affordability of our system, and we can actually go faster with renewables if we're using some natural gas. Now, over time, we're going to use it differently, no question about mm-hmm. it. But we can't simply say we're done with it today because we don't have the technology at the moment to operate the grid without it.
Which I think is a pivotal question in terms of who pays for it in the end. I know that Duke is starting to figure out how quickly they want to move. Do you have an idea of how much consumers will pay up to be greener?
So we actually, every a couple of years in our states where we're in the electric business, file what's called an integrated resource plan, where we tell our regulators what we plan to build in order to meet the demand that we expect to see over the course of the next 15 years. And as part of that, we talk about what the costs will be. And in both Virginia and South Carolina, we see as we move toward this greener grid that you and I have been talking about, that over the course of the next 15 years, we're talking about 2% a year average increase in electric bills, which we think is pretty manageable when you think about the benefits of moving toward fewer emissions, less carbon.
So let's get to then the green stuff. Where Dominion is really staking a huge claim is wind, and a humongous offshore wind project. Should be about $10 billion, right? Can you tell me about the project, how it came about, how you're thinking about it?
I can. And it is going to be the largest offshore wind farm in the United States. And really, its genesis goes back to 2013, at the time the federal government auctioned off a lease area off the coast of Virginia. And my predecessor, Tom Farrell, made the very smart move. And we are to date, the only utility that bid on and won a lease area. In this case, we paid less than $2 million for that lease area. And then we worked at what would make sense for our customers to build it out. And we started off with a couple of turbines that we have out 27 miles off the coast of Virginia Beach operating today. They've now been operating for more than a year. They're the only turbines in federal waters off the coast of the United States. And they've been operating even better than we expected. And that gave us a real understanding of how to do these projects. So this is obviously a small scale compared to what we're going to do, which is 176 turbines that we'll build out between now and the end of 2026. And ultimately, that project, when it's operating at full capacity, will provide enough electricity for 660,000 homes in Virginia and the Carolinas.
Has the cost profile changed of that?
Since we first announced our expectation that we were going to build this project, and that was a couple of years ago, we've seen mm-hmm. inflationary pressure like everyone has seen in projects that were building. Commodity prices a little bit higher than we might have seen a couple of years ago. But interestingly, at the same time, the project that we've had operating off the coast so far, it's been generating more electricity than we expected. And the data that we've gotten as we've further studied this project indicates we're going to generate more electricity from the turbines a larger percentage of the time than we had originally expected. So commodity pressure up, but the amount of electricity generated also up, which keeps the cost per unit of electricity about the same as what we've been talking about for a while. So we think we can manage the costs.
Well, to that point, but more on the wind generation part, if you're able to move faster on the renewable front, does it mean that you get to wind down your natural gas plants faster, or is it just an extra bonus?
It means that we generate electricity maybe less often from natural gas. And obviously, with solar and wind, the fuel is free. And there's a real benefit to that. So to the extent that we're operating more renewables earlier, then less generation and less fuel costs on the natural gas side of things. But again, always balancing, making sure that we're able to do this reliably, no matter what the weather conditions that we have to deal with.
So tell me about some recent accomplishments with the wind farm. What are you most excited about? And what's still a big hurdle in real development there?
Yeah, so last year we said that we would file for our permit with the federal government, the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management, by the end of the year, which we did. And we said we expected that we would get a what's called a notice of intent, sort of a schedule for the rest of the permitting process by the middle of this year, which we did. So I think it's really important for people to understand these are lengthy permitting processes, but one that is very much on schedule as we anticipated it would be. And schedule certainty and permitting timing certainty for any infrastructure project, but certainly for one like this, is critical. If the permits drag out, then the costs go up, and that's bad for our customers. So I think, to me, what's most exciting is that we're on track on the permitting schedule process. And I would say that the technology of these turbines has really improved. So the two turbines that we have operating today are 6 megawatts each. And the ones that we expect to build will be more than 14 megawatts. So twice as much electricity generated from these newer generation turbines than the ones that we installed just a year ago. So really incredible progress on the technology.
That's an enormous difference. Picking up on that a little bit, I'm curious as you make this shift, what do you do with your labor force? I mean, can you get the guy who's running the coal plant to go and work in the wind project? Like, how do you deal with it?
Yeah, that's a great question, and one that unfortunately we've been dealing with for a while, because we have decommissioned some of our coal plants, and that's a tough thing to do, because the folks who work in those plants have served our customers incredibly well for a long time. Those are hard jobs, and every time you hit the switch and your lights come on, you should thank someone who's worked in a coal plant or a fossil plant. But thanks is, I'm sure they appreciate our thanks, but that's not enough. They're looking for jobs. And so far, when we've had to do this, we've had other opportunities at the company and other plants. We're certainly focused on training and retraining our workforce so that they can move into these more renewable type technician jobs. It's something that's important for our company, important for the communities where those plants have been operating for a long time, something that we work on very hard. But fundamentally, we're going to be generating less electricity from one source and more from another, and we need to try to transition the workforce that way.
What kind of workers do you need on a wind project?
Well, you need technicians. When you're actually constructing, you need every kind of skilled trade you could imagine. And then operating them, we need technicians to operate and maintain those facilities. And obviously, as I mentioned, that's 27 miles off the coast. So a slightly different skill set than you might have in the mountains of Southwest Virginia.
Yeah. For business, from a worker perspective, the whole thing. So if we undergo what happened in Texas last winter again this year, and there was one rhetoric that blamed the shift to renewables, there was the actual fact about it, that a natural gas plant was frozen over, so it wasn't able to operate, et cetera. Do you think that alternative energy is going to be to blame again? Like, do you think that this is going to be a constant theme that we're going to hear?
Yeah, you know, it does seem like, as with many issues, people approach a problem from whatever their notion was before the problem existed. Fact is, in Texas, their system was not equipped to handle the conditions that they were finding themselves operating in. From our point of view, that had a lot to do with the regulatory structure in Texas. So if you think about where we are in Virginia and in South Carolina, if we believe we need to weatherize a power station in order to handle adverse conditions, we go to our regulators and we prove that out. We're allowed to make that investment. In Texas, generators were paid for when they generated electricity, but they didn't have any incentive necessarily to be able to make these rather significant investments to have power plants ready to operate under those kind of conditions. So I think there was a regulatory market issue in Texas, and we should all be thinking about that. But immediately deciding because you are either pro or anti renewables or fossil that that's the source of the problem, I think doesn't really get to the issue. I think you need to think about what incentives what incentives you're giving the people who are supposed to be generating and providing electricity and natural gas.
But to that point, it feels like the energy crisis that we're seeing unfold in Europe is more directly related to green energy in that there just isn't enough natural gas to get to them. The other part of the story is you don't have the storage capability for solar and wind to be able to use that. So it's all creating that energy crisis. And I just wonder how much of the next decade is the energy transition going to be to blame for stuff? Either it's higher prices, energy prices, other issues. Like, what do you think?
I think it's our responsibility in our industry to make sure that we do this transition in a way that maintains the reliability of our service. We have an obligation to serve. As I mentioned earlier, that's been the most important thing for us since we started. It's going to continue to be the most important thing. So what we're going to do at Dominion Energy Virginia, Dominion Energy South Carolina, and then in Utah and Ohio, where North Carolina, where we're a gas distribution company, is we're going to demonstrate to policymakers, to regulators, and to our customers the importance of the different sources that we use to provide them energy. And my view is, as long as we maintain a diverse supply, we're going to be able to handle adverse conditions, all the while moving toward that goal of greening our fleet.
We only have a few more minutes left, but I'd love to get your take on hydrogen. I feel like green hydrogen is all I'm hearing about right now, but in actuality, it's really hard and no one's really cracked the code yet. Where does green hydrogen specifically fit into your category and into your business?
Yeah, so there are a couple places that we're thinking about it. As I mentioned, we're a gas distribution company, and we're actually undertaking pilots in a couple different states to blend hydrogen in with the methane that is the normal part of our gas distribution business. So that will obviously reduce emissions when people burn hydrogen, or a blend in this case of hydrogen.
So would that be more blue? Is that more blue hydrogen?
Right. So right now what we're doing is focusing less on the source of that hydrogen and focusing more on the effect, making sure that our system, that people's appliances can handle it. Then we need to turn to how you get hydrogen, which is a pretty significant challenge. A lot of companies are working on that. Through electrolysis and electricity, you can create hydrogen. And if you do that using nuclear or renewables, then that's emissions free. That's a lot of capacity that we would need to develop. But I think maybe the best way to think about these issues is there may not be one single silver bullet. It might not be just hydrogen. It might also be renewable natural gas, like we're developing, taking methane from hog and dairy farms and capturing that instead of allowing it to go up into the atmosphere and using it as pipeline quality gas. There could be potentially a carbon capture and storage, additional nuclear through small modular reactors, which I think may have some promise sometime off in the future. So the way I think about it, at least, is this isn't, we're not looking for one silver bullet. We're looking for a lot of pieces that will fit together to allow us to continue this transition, again, reliably and affordably.
Do you, and I asked you this question before, but I think it's worth asking again. This is the last question for you. Do you think that investors and consumers and people get that? Because that message is a lot harder to get across than all coal is bad, all natural gas is bad, only solar and wind are good.
Oftentimes, the more nuanced and probably more correct messages are harder to get across. But I think our view is, and this is something that we frequently say at Dominion Energy, is actions speak louder. So rather than talking as much about it, we're going to demonstrate through our results that we can do this in a way that's good for customers and achieves the goals that we're looking for and society is looking for.
Look, Bob, it was a real pleasure to talk to you. It's great to learn about where you are in this energy transition. Excited to see how this continues to play out. Thank you so much for being a part of this and being a part of a Bloomberg Sustainable Business Summit focus on finance. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Alix.